Hello everyone, so today we'll be talking about history taking in orthopedics. So basically in orthopedics the history taking is same as in the other subject like medicine, but there are some difference in the presenting complaint and their history of presenting illness. So let's talk about that. So before history, before noting the patient particular, first of all we should understand that developing a rapport with patient and establishing communication with patient is very important. The patient should be made comfortable and it should be there should be well understanding between the patient and the doctor. There should be proper rapport building and the establishing communication is important. And so after that, next will be the patient particular. We have to note the patient particulars. We have to note the name and the age. The age has its own significance. There are some fractures which are more common in children and others are more often occur in adult or elderly. And by knowing the age, we can think that a possible injury which could be occur at any age. So patient with congenital malformation such as developmental dysplasia of hip can be present in early life, and in the infection and bone tumor are also common in children. And that whereas the degenerative condition like osteoarthritis is more common in older age. So by looking at the age, we can guess the particular disease. So for the pediatric problem like polio, rickets, Porteus disease, slipped capital epiphysis, acute osteomyelitis, and septic arthritis, these are more present in pediatric group. The bone malignancy are more present in adolescent, and the disease like rheumatoid arthritis is present in middle age, like 20 to 40 years. So that's all. And in six, the some diseases are more common in male, whereas some are more common in female. The CDS is more common in female. The congenital dislocation hip is more common in female. The rheumatoid arthritis, ankylosing spondylitis is rheumatoid arthritis is more common in female. Ankylosing spondylitis is more common in male. And so similarly, slipped epiphysis is more common in male. So that's how there is age difference. And occupation is very important in the field of orthopedics. What the patient does as is on very much relevance in the orthopedic area as compared to other discipline. The number of complaints can be traced back to the kind of occupation. For example, a patient who is required to bend forward and lift heavy weight in course of his job may develop back strain. And in cases where cure is not possible, physical requirement of the patient become the basis for deciding the treatment. For example, a little limp due to instability at cost of gaining movement at it may be acceptable for a wiser, but the same can be very disabling for the heavy man or worker. So similarly, the lifestyle of patient, for example, like habit of sitting on the floor may become very important consideration while treatment planning the treatment. So occupation is very, very important in the orthopedic. And now talking about presenting complaint, we have various presenting complaint like pain, difficulty in using the limbs, inability to walk, limp, deformity of limb, swelling, stiffness, weakness, discharging sinus and altered sensation. These are some presenting complaint or symptom complaint of orthopedic. And in history of presenting illness, one must give the patient time to settle down, and first of all, this should be elaborated. All the presenting complaints should be elaborated in detail. So broadly, the orthopedic disease can be divided into two groups. That is one, trauma related and non trauma related. So first of all, while elaborating the history, so we should think in the mind the first question. We have to ask the first question that whether there was any trauma before the onset of symptom or not. So a number of patients may falsely implicate a unrelated episode of trauma as a cause of their disease. A detailed inquiry into the nature of injury, the period between the injury and onset of symptom can help in deciding whether injury did play a role in causing the disease or not. The various leading question like when did the injury occur in relation to the onset of symptom, that is, whether the injury was immediately preceding or few days or few weeks before the symptom, and how did the injury occur, to assess whether severity of trauma was sufficient to cause whatever the patient complained, and of also to know the exact mode of injury, and that did patient have any complaints such as pain, swelling, and immediately following the trauma, or they occur after a few days or week. And next one is, was the patient able to carry out his activity despite his injury, or in case of child, did the child continue to play after injury? Obviously, if this was so, the episode of trauma is unlikely to be related to the symptom. And was the patient given any treatment? Did he get any acetone at the time? This suggests that the injury was serious enough. And if one is sure that the disease is not related to trauma, inquire into the type of onset of the symptom, like whether the symptom was acute, subacute, or chronic. And next one, we have the progress of disease. This consists of finding out how the symptom progressed over the period of time. The question one must ask are whether it is a progressively worsening disease, is it a disease with remission or exacerbation, is it a disease which come rather suddenly and subsided over the period of time. Any treatment carried out during the period and its effects should also be noted. At the end, one should make an assessment of the current status of the patient, his functional activity, severity of pain, etc. And so that was all about how we should proceed in the history of presenting illness. Now we will elaborate, and in SOPI we have to elaborate the detail about this presenting complaint. So first of all, talking about the pain. The pain is the most common symptom in the orthopedic. The pain may be at the site of disease, or it may be pain referred from the other part, and the various the pain can be the details about pain can be elicited by the mnemonic Socrate, the famous mnemonic that is used in medicine too. So what is the exact site? Psi as in for site. What is the exact site of the pain? We should try to be as specific as possible, and this it helps to ask the patient to point out the site of the pain. And next we have the onset. What was the onset of the pain? Whether it was acute or chronic type of pain or that. And nextly, we have to present over the character of the pain. What was the character? This may site, onset, character. And next, we have the radiation, very important. Does the pain radiate to some other area? It is common in the limbs to have pain originating in one part and radiating to another part. For example, in the from the neck, if there is some pathology in the neck, the pain may radiate to shoulder and arm. Similarly, if the shoulder pathology may radiate their pain into the arm. Similarly, in sciatica, the pain radiates from buttocks to back, gluteal, from back of thigh and knee. So that's about radiation. And we have to do if there is any associated symptoms or if there is anything else. Next one, we have the timing. We have to ask if the present is present at all times, or pain due to neoplasia is present all times and it may fluctuate. What is this person said? Or pain due to trauma is maximum within 4 to 6 hours of injury and then starts subsiding. Or pain of inflammatory origin builds up rather suddenly and then subsides. And remission and exacerbation are seen in pain due to chronic inflammatory disease such as rheumatoid arthritis. A sudden appearance of pain in rather painless disease is an indication of change of nature of disease. For example, it could be malignant change in the benign swelling or pathological fracture through a bone affected with some disease. And we have to do exacerbating and relieving factor. We should ask what really aggravates and relieves the pain. A pain of mechanical origin becomes worse with activity and improves with rest. And on the other hand, a pain of the chronic inflammation like osteoarthritis and rheumatoid arthritis comes up after the period of rest and improves with activity. And we have to ask about the severity, and we have to ask if the pain is very severe or mild, moderate, we have to ask about the severity of the pain. So that is all about SOR, Socrates. Now next symptom is difficulty in using the limbs. This is usually a result of pain, and sometimes the stiffness of joint deformity or muscle weakness may be responsible for difficulty or in using the limb, especially the upper limb. And in the inability back, same as like this, this may be due to pain. And it is important to know at what rate the disease has progressed to cause whatever limitation of walking, whether it has been sudden, over days, or over week. Limping, this is common early symptom in the patient with lower limb disease. Limping is of two types. That is, one is whether the limp is painful or painless. And the painful limp is present in the condition like any traumatic condition of limb, any inflammatory condition of limb like tuberculosis of hip, osteoarthritis of hip, and the painless condition of limping are present in the condition like polio affecting lower limb, the coxa-vara deformity, DDS, deformity of joint or bone, fused hip, knee, ankle, and the, in this condition there are painless limb. The deformity of limb is next complaint. It is required to know the onset of deformity. The deformity following an episode of injury could be due to subluxation or dislocation of the joint, or a malunion or non-union of the fracture. It may be result of complication related to the trauma, and in an acute painful condition the deformity comes up due to muscle spasm initiated by pain, and later contracture of the muscle and capsule develop. Gradual progress of deformity occur in the chronic infection, growth related disorder, or in gradually worsening disease. And it is important to know whether the deformity is progressive or static, and what does the deformity not allow the patient to do. The swelling with or without pain is common complaint. When without or with a little pain, it is due to the benign growth or low grade malignant growth. The swelling following a fracture may be due to callus formation or displacement at a fracture site. Swelling associated with pain is due to inflammatory or neoplastic disorder. The way the pain, swelling progress indicate the its etiology. A neoplastic swelling keeps on growing whatever the rate may be. On other hand, the inflammatory swelling has remission after initial rapid onset. And the key question is whether the swelling ever reduces in size. If it did, it suggests that it is not a neoplastic swelling. And the swelling at more than one site are seen in the disease like neurofibromatosis, multiple exostosis, multifocal tuberculosis, or polyarthritis. And next we have the stiffness. Stiffness is a symptom of joint involvement. In early stage of disease, stiffness occurs due to a protective spasm of the muscle around the joint. And this is the nature's way of avoiding movement of a painful joint. And in late stage, the joint becomes stiff due to intra-articular or extra-articular adhesion. The stiffness is the nature's way of avoiding the movement of painful joint. The late stage, the joint becomes stiff due to intra-articular or extra-articular adhesion. And in advanced stage, the severe limitation of joint occurs, and this is called ankylosis of joint. And the cause of ankylosis could be intra-articular or extra-articular. The intra-articular causes of ankylosis include the tuberculosis, septic arthritis, viral arthritis, and the extra-articular cause of ankylosis include the myositis, arthrogryposis multiplex congenita, bone contracture, scleroderma, and other various diseases. And the inflammatory disease like rheumatoid arthritis and ankylosing spondylitis, the stiffness increases after rest, but improves with activity. Nextly, we have the weakness. Weakness of limb is due to loss of muscle power. This could be secondary to disuse, atrophy of the muscle, or due to some neurological condition. And the cause of neurological weakness may be affection to brain like stroke, spinal cord, for example, the poliomyelitis, or not the neuropathy, neuromuscular junction in the myasthenia or muscle. And if there is no associated sensory loss, the cause may be either myopathy, neuropathy, or motor nerve, or polio, or other motor neuron disease. The onset of weakness may be sudden or as in injury, or insidious as in myopathy, leprosy, and the weakness is progressive in neuropathy and myopathy, but it improves with time in polio. And the discharging sinus, the sinus discharging pulses over a period of time, not healing with usual complaint, may indicate deeper infection, and this could be underlying bone infection. The history of discharge of single piece of bone sequestrum from the sinus is sure evidence of bone involvement. And other cause of persistent discharging sinus are the generalized diseases like diabetes, the resistant bacteria, fungal infection, osteomyelitis, foreign body, epithelialization of sinus, scar tissue around sinus, and malignant change in the sinus. And there may be altered sensation. Next symptom is the altered sensation that may be due to the neurological cause, peripheral neuropathy. And now we have, after history of presenting illness, we have the next topic, that is past illness. Some illness in the past may give rise to symptom years after the apparent healing of the disease. So old injury, the osteoarthritis presenting with pain and stiffness is common many years after joint is damaged due to the injury or infection. And in old infection, recurrence may occur after apparent healing of the infection. An old tuberculosis lesion anywhere in the body may present as tuberculosis in the bone or joint. And the personal history, the occupation of the patient, his living style, the kind of physical activity is required to, etc., having a bearing in the treatment. The family history may be relevant or in the genetically transmitted disorder and in tuberculosis. And the socioeconomic history is very important in accessing the treatment planning, and about it also helps to give the clue about various diseases. So thank you about we will talk about examination part in next video. This was all about history taking in orthopedics. Thank you and have a good day.